Welcome, everybody. Good morning. We are so excited you joined us again this week for our Radical Living. Thank you so much for making the Word of God a priority in your life. You know, as you see today, I have Melissa with me today. She is our second born. Melody is on a trip with her dad, ministering the Word of God in Europe and in Africa, and she will be back in 2 weeks. So you have the great pleasure and the great privilege to have Melissa with you these next 2 weeks. You know, she's an incredible young woman, you know, with a really big heart for the things of God, and she has incredible testimonies in her life. One of them, I think you will hear today, you know, as we talk to you guys today about, you know, shutting the enemy out of our lives. Please, before we get started, feel free to like and share this broadcast, you know, make it available to as many people as possible. We want this really to go out into the world, you know, to make a difference and bless the people. But before we get started, let's just start with a word of prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for a brand new day, Lord Jesus. Thank you for a brand new opportunity today to serve you, Lord Jesus, to dig into your word, Lord Jesus, to learn from you, Lord. Father, we pray, Lord, that you give us ears to hear today, Lord Jesus, and a heart that is wide open, Lord, to receive from you, your Lord Jesus, the truth from your word, Lord Jesus. Help us to receive it, to make changes where we need to make changes, Lord Jesus, and to live accordingly, Lord Jesus, so our lives can make an impact in this world. We love you, we praise you, we give you all the glory today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen, amen. Amen. You know, like I said, today we want to talk to you guys today about shutting the enemy out of our lives. And you know, we know from the Word of God that the enemy came to kill, to steal, and to destroy. You know, that's his plan for our life. And you know, his biggest accomplishment would be to see a believer living a life of compromise. You know, a life of compromise that is not 100% committed to the things of God. And if he can keep us in a place like this, he's happy. You know, he is successful, because he knows then when we're not walking 100% with God and having giving him complete authority over our lives, that we cannot make the full impact that we were meant to be, that we were created to make. And you know, he always makes sin look pleasing to you. You know, he would never tempt you with anything that is not in the realm of your interest. You know, he always makes it sound logical. You know, he always makes it look pleasing to you, so it feels pleasing to you, or it tastes pleasing to you. You know, and as long as our door is open to the enemy, you know, just a little bit, I don't know what you call that in English, if it's just a spalt in German, you say
just,
a spalt,
a little bit
open, you know, he can have has the right to walk into your life and mess with you whenever he wants to. And trust me, he will do that, because he wants to keep you in this place of compromise. He wants to keep you in a place where you're not 100% committed and 100% effective for the Word of God. So we as believers need to learn to keep those doors in our life closed, you know, to really shut the enemy out. You know, if a door is locked and secure and you're confident about that, you know, then he can try as long as he wants, but he will fail every single time. And you know, that is possible. We can live lives in that way. We don't have to be constantly battled by the enemy. You know, we can really live and have peace of mind that he cannot mess with us. So today, before Melissa starts, I want to give her a good time today, because she really has something to say, especially also in this generation. But before I give it over to her, I just want to cover four areas really quick of our lives, you know, that we need to learn to shut the enemy out, you know, to keep that door closed and to work actively on it. And you know, the very first area that we need to be mindful of is our mind. You know, the Word of God in Proverbs 4 verse 20 says, and I want to read this here real quick, I have it written down because I like this translation better, but it says here, Proverbs 4:20, it says, "My child, listen carefully to everything I say. Don't forget a single word, but think about it all. Knowing these things will mean true life and good health for you. Carefully guard your thoughts, because they are the source of true life." You know, we see here from the Word of God that we need to choose. You know, we need to control what and whom we're letting into our mind. You know, our mind is such an incredible, incredible blessing from the Lord of God. You know, we can potentially store 100 trillion ideas and thoughts, and if we use it for the glory of God, that is wonderful, you know, to dream big and to listen to His voice and receive it, then it's a blessing, you know. But we need to learn to guard our mind, you know, of the things that are not pleasing to God. You know, think about the things that you're thinking about, you know, really examine your own thoughts and look, you know, stop and ask yourself, are these thoughts evil or good thoughts, God-pleasing thoughts? You know, do they glorify man or do they glorify God? You know, remember, sin always starts with a thought. Mm-hmm. You know, temptation is a thought that if we're not learning to take that captive, it will manifest sooner or later to something bigger in our life. You know, sin always starts with a thought. So we, especially as believers, need to be aware of, you know, that it's an area that we really need to learn, you know, to take control of those thoughts. And as soon as something hits you that you realize, whoa, where is this coming from? This is not from the Word of God. Start praying and contradict it with the Word of God, what the Word of God says in those areas. You know, think about what is feeding your thoughts. Mm. You know, what movies are you watching? What music are you listening to? You know, so many people say, you know, this is just entertainment. I have had multiple conversations with couples and people, even, you know, my age, who say, you know, that's not a big deal. It's just entertainment. You know, after a long day of work, I just like to relax and I like to watch certain shows. And we talked about shows, you know, where it's really sin is plain in your eyes. Even some of the titles are telling you already exactly what this show is about, and so many believers don't have a problem watching that stuff. But you know what they don't realizing is that you're feeding your conscience constantly, you know, and stuff like this has an impact. And all of a sudden we realize, you know, that we have become numb in certain areas. Why? Because we have been constantly looking at things that we should not have looked at. You know, our senses, our spiritual senses need to stay alert. They need to stay sharp, you know, so we can recognize something. And, you know, music and movies and stuff like this have a huge, huge impact that go deep into your soul, and they're influencing you. You know, there's so many, think about music. You know, the devil himself was a worship leader, so this is right down his alley. He knows what he's doing in this area. And I know Melissa probably will go into this a little bit more, but you know, there's so many artists there, non-Christian singers, that really have given their life to the enemy. You know, they sold their soul just for success, and you know, their music is accordingly. And you know, there's those songs, they're very popular, you know, because the enemy, he's gifted in that area, and he uses that. And you know, then you hear a tune and it's with you all day long, and then you know, you don't even realize how it really goes into your subconscious. You know, what are the things that you're reading, that you're looking at? Those are all things, you know, we need to guard our mind and fill it with God glorifying things, especially with the Word of God. You know, that is the best thing that we can feed our mind with. You know, the second area that where we really need to shut the enemy out is our own heart. You know, Proverbs says here, above all else, guard your heart. Mm-hmm. You know, to experience the full measure of of our faith, the fullness of our faith in God, we must recognize the treasure of our own heart. You know, above all else communicates priority in our lives. You know, above all else communicates the utmost important. You know, it communicates our full attention. We see here in this text, you know, that guarding our heart is more important than anything else. And this means that we need to prioritize and protect our heart. And you know, how do we do that? You know, we do that by eliminating trash in our life. You know, by the things that are not pleasing to God. You know, there are some sins and lifestyle that we would all agree, you know, that, oh yeah, it's not good to live like this. You know, the obvious one, like, you know, moral corruption, you know, an adulterous lifestyle, perverse behavior, evil acts that harm others. Those are all the obvious ones, you know, that we would all agree on, you know, but then there's other areas in our lives that are a little bit more difficult to discern, a little bit more difficult to acknowledge and to remove from our life, you know, so, you know that could be unwillingness to forgive, you know, a lack of faith in our life, you know, pride, putting others down so we look better, you know, gossip could be one of those things. It doesn't matter, you know, trash, big or small, is still trash.
Yeah.
You know, and we should embrace the same challenge that the Apostle Paul gave Timothy, you know, when he said, purify yourself so that you are a special instrument that is pleasing to the master. You know, I really like this verse, and in fact, I really would like to just do a whole broadcast just on this one verse. You know, we as believers, we are called to be special instrument, you know, fit for the master to use us, and you know that is beautiful. You know, we need to energize our heart with the transforming truth of the Word of God. You know, we never treat the Word of God as just a collection of facts, but pay attention to what the Word of God says, because God's Word is alive. You know, it is sharper than any two-edged sword. You know, the prophet Jeremiah describes the Word of God as a fire that burns in a man's soul and a hammer that shatters a rock to pieces. You know, if that fire, excuse me, Michaela, if that fire is alive and burning in our heart and in our soul, then there is no room for trash in our life. And this brings me to my third point today. You know, the third area that we really need to protect in our life and shut the enemy out of is our lips. You know, the very confessions that come out of our very mouth. You know, the Word of God says, set a guard upon my mouth, O Lord. You know, we talked about it, excuse me, we talked about it last week, about, you know, how the tongue is really the tongue is really depends I lost my train of thought really quickly, but we talked about it last week about the importance of our tongue and how it defines, you know, life on death in our own life. You know, what we confess, the things that we speak over our lives is so important. You know, what confessions are coming out of your life? Are you constantly saying, you know, life is so hard, I'm nothing but stressed, I'm so tired, I don't feel good? You know, then those are exactly the things that you harvest, yeah, in your life. Are you constantly engaged in gossip? looking for fault in everybody else? You know, are you trying to put people around you down? You know, then this is an area, you know, where you need to take a step back and pay attention to, you know, work on this area in your life. You see, these first three points that we have covered really go hand in hand. You know, our mind, our heart, and our lips, they are so related. You know, even the word of God says, for out of the abundance of our heart, so the mouth will speak. Mm-hmm. You know, things that you constantly ponder on and think on for a while will eventually come out of your mind, of your mouth, because they have been in your mind for a while. You know, if I don't know if you have ever been around people that say things, you know, in a choking way, but then they would always say, I didn't mean to say that. I didn't mean to say that, you know, and so many times probably they have, because that obviously is something they have been thinking about, something they have been pondering about. And you know, because out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks.
Yeah,
so what,
right.
What's in our heart is really coming out. You know, if you are filled with the word of God and you're spending your days and you're starting your days in worship, then that's what is coming out of you, and our life is a living proof of that. You know, but another really, really important aspect I want to bring in here real quick regarding our confessions and regarding our mouth is that, you know, the Lord has given us the authority over the enemy. And, you know, we as believers need to learn to walk in that authority. You know, we can stand up to the enemy. We don't need to be battled day in and day out. You know,
sure.
I personally, I don't wait for a crisis to happen before I put him in the place where he belongs. I don't wait before an attack is happening before I stand up and pray. You know, I make this a point in my life, and every time I pray, you know, I take a time, you know, of declarations that I pray over the ministry, declarations that I pray over our partners that stand faithfully with us, you know, over our family, over my girls. You know, those are all areas where I declare the word of God, straight from the word of God, declare blessing, life, prosperity into those areas. And I make it a point to address the enemy personally.
Mm.
You know, I'm telling him who he cannot mess with on this day. And I cover my kids and I cover us as a family in the ministry. I back this up with the word of God, because that's our authority that we have towards him. You know, if you are a believer, that is your portion. That is your, you have been given that same authority, you know, to stand up and to speak against the enemy day after day. And the fourth area that I want to cover here real quick, where we really need to shut the enemy out, is in our relationships. You know, choose wisely, you know, the people that you are hanging with. Of course, I'm not talking about evangelizing, you know, that is a whole different area. We need to go out and evangelize to everybody. It doesn't matter how they look like. It doesn't matter the lifestyle they're living. God has called us to do so. But I'm mm-hmm. talking here about people that you spend quality time with, people that are close to you in your life. You know, who are you letting in? You know, is those relationships, are they God glorifying? You know, do they point you to Christ? Every time when you spend time with them, you feel energized, you feel refreshed, you feel encouraged, you know, or do you feel they're pulling you down? Every time you leave a person like this, you feel heavy, and it takes you all afternoon to get yourself picked up again. You know, I myself have distanced myself from people before, because I realized they're not good for me. Every time I left with them, I felt heavy and I felt yucky, and I realized this is not doing me any good. So it is, there is nothing wrong with it, you know, to distance yourself from people that are not good for you. You know, as a mom, over the years, I have always known when my kids would hang with friends that are not good for them, you know, because all of a sudden you see an attitude change in the home. You see a different behavior. And I would always ask them two things. My husband and I, you know, we would always say, how is your devotion time going? You know, when you realize all of a sudden something is up and attitudes are completely different. And secondly is, whom are you hanging with? You know, I would always tell my kids, you know, choose your friends wisely and make sure that you are the one influencing and you are not the one being influenced. You know, just because these kids go to church or people go to church doesn't necessarily mean that they are good for you. Yeah. You know, I cannot tell you enough, you know, how many testimonies and conversations we had over the years with the ministry where we see that especially young men, you know, in a really young age were influenced in the church, in Sunday school, in their youth group, and they were introduced to pornography, for instance, in church, you know, and as a result thereof, they struggled their whole growing up years, their young adult lives, and either they're really getting a breakthrough with the Lord and getting to getting the victory over that area, or in some cases even, you know, where we see that whole families were destroyed, you know, because you can't hide it forever. You know, if you sin in the dark, soon the light will shine on it and stuff will come out. And in some cases, it has been that whole families were destroyed because of it, you know. So just because some people come to church regularly doesn't necessarily mean they are a good influence in you. You know, surround yourself with people that are like-minded, you know, carry the same passion as you do, people that you look up to, you know, that encouraging you, that speak into life, even people, you know, that are further in their walk with the Lord as you are, people that you admire because their very life is a proof of a deep relationship to God in their life. You know, sometimes the enemy uses the very people that we are close to influence us negatively, you know, to bring us down, to sow seeds of doubt or even seeds of fear in our life. You know, we as believers need to learn to protect our mind, you know, to keep trash out of our heart, you know, to watch carefully what comes out of our mouth and make God really a priority, making good confessions over our life. And, you know, choose our friends and the people we hang around with wisely.
Yeah, that's so good. All of that is just, they're just so important, such important points if we really do want to shut that door to the enemy and not even let him just have a foothold in our lives. So I want to start off just with sharing a testimony that happened in my life that where I did let the enemy have a foothold. So growing up, we were always very, my parents, they were very careful, like what they let us watch, what they let us listen to, just the entertainment scene, what we were allowed to like put into our minds and stuff like that. But when I was really little, I want to say I was like 7 or 8. Do you remember how old I was? I was
not
really
sure
small.
Where you're going with this.
Yeah. But, yeah. Sorry. But yeah. So I was at a sleepover, and at this family's house, they showed us a movie that was all about like witches and like very like underlying demonic things, like very dark, very scary. And I had never been exposed to that because I was, you know, protected from that from my parents. And so when I saw that movie, I just got so scared. I was freaked out. I was terrified. And I can remember that. I can trace back to that point, starting then when I saw that movie, that a door of fear just opened up in my life. And I struggled with fear for so many years, probably until I was 15 years old. I really struggled heavily with fear, just in every area. If I saw something or heard something, even if it wasn't even that scary, I would just get so afraid. I remember so many times I would have nightmares at night and I just couldn't sleep. I remember one time actually for 2 months in a row, I wasn't able to sleep because I was just so afraid, like this fear would consume me. I feel like there's levels of fear, and there's like, you know, fear where it's like, oh no, you know, you kind of just have that. But then there's like consuming fear, and that's what I felt like. I felt like it was consuming me, and that I couldn't break free from it. So that's just because of that movie that I watched. It opened that door for me, and to live with that for so many years. And then when I was 12 years old, my parents, we started going to a church, and a different church, and we went to their youth group. And I still remember during worship, I was just on my knees in worship before the Lord, and I remember feeling the presence of God so strongly. It's almost like I could touch it. Like it was just such a tangible presence of God. And so from that point on, I made a decision to actively really pursue the Lord for myself. I made a commitment to really read the Bible with intention of just knowing and understanding the Word of God and really pursuing God actively. And so I just started doing that. And, you know, you start reading the Word of God. And once you start reading the Word of God, you know, the lies that the enemy puts in your head are kind of brought to light. Mm-hmm. And so I just, so many places in the Bible, God told us that we don't have to live in fear. In fact, he actually commands us, do not be afraid. And if we're going against a command of God, that's us living in sin, you know? And so I just started to realize, I was like, man, God, he didn't give me this fear. I'm not supposed to like walk like this. I'm not supposed to live like this. And then I remember, actually my cousin, he gave me a verse, just out of nowhere. He just, wrote it down for me and gave it to me. And I don't even think that he really knew what I was going through, but it was Joshua 1:9 that says, be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And so I just started reading that verse every day. And then a little while later, Melody, she gave me a verse, that's in 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. Mm-hmm. And so just those two verses, I started taking them, and I made them my verses. I made them my own. I was like, I do not have a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. I am strong and courageous. And I would just start to speak those verses over my life. And the more I did it, the more I realized that my fear was becoming less and less. And I would just start to see just a change that, you know, I didn't have that constant fear at night when I was going to bed or you know, whatever it was during the day. I was just at so much more peace. And I just give God the glory for that. But I feel like so many times, you know, I just kind of want to touch on what my mom touched on with just movies and entertainment and all of that stuff. So many times we think that, you know, that it doesn't influence us. You know, it's like in our minds, we're like, it's not real. It's kind of just a story being told and it can't influence us, but it influences us. If it influences us in more ways than we know, yeah. You know, that movie was the door that opened up those years of fear for me. Mm-hmm. And of course it progressed, but it was the beginning point of that. And you know, the enemy, he likes to use entertainment, just like my mom was saying. He likes to use that stuff because it, because you know, he kind of can get you with a storyline, like, oh, it's a good storyline. But there's like things, the video games that you're playing, the movies that you're watching, the music you're listening to, the books that you're reading. We have to guard ourselves. Yeah. Just like my mom, she was talking about that verse, you know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. But like, what are you putting in your heart? What are you constantly feeding yourself? Because what goes in comes out.
Yeah.
And just like my mom was saying, sometimes people say stuff and you're like, where did that come from? It's because of what they've been putting into their lives. So many times, you know, people, they're so confused. They're like, why am I having such lustful thoughts? Why am I having, you know, fear? But it's like, what are you watching? Are you watching dirty movies? Are you watching horror movies? You know, things like that, they influence us and in so many ways. And, you know, I was taking a film class at UCF.
Yeah.
And they were going, we were just learning about the different directors of different movies, and a lot of the movies that that we were learning about were like just like horror movies and stuff like that. And so I didn't really like that class. But anyway, so I was learning about the directors, and if you really learn about them and like kind of like dig into like their characteristics, like their personalities and stuff, you see there's a very heavy demonic influence in their lives. And you can even see it, even they showed a picture and I could just see it in their eyes, like just that demonic influence that's in their lives. And that's carried through the movies that they create, or like even music. I've heard countless artists that actually say they're woken up by demons at night and that's how they get their lyrics. Yeah. And then we think that we can just listen to those songs without being influenced. It's just, I get very passionate about it because we have to guard ourselves. I always think this, you know, like if Jesus himself would walk in while I'm watching a movie or while I'm listening to a song, playing a game, reading a book, if he would walk in, would I be embarrassed by what I'm watching or by what I'm entertaining myself with right now? Or would, you know, would he be proud of me? Would he be proud of the things that I'm guarding my heart with? You know what I mean? And so anyway, so that's a really big point that the Lord has really spoken to me. So I made a commitment to be very careful with the movies that I watch. And sometimes it's, you know, if you're over at a friend's house and you have to explain to them like, hey, sorry, I can't watch this, what you want to watch right now, you know? So sometimes it's hard, but it's so worth it because you can guard yourself from so much. Just like if I wouldn't have watched that movie when I was small, I would have guarded myself from so much. You know what I mean? So yeah, but if we do fall into that, you know, where we do give the enemy a foothold, like I did, so many times I feel like we think that it's something that we kind of have to deal with our whole lives. That was for me, I know, my mindset. Before I started reading the word, like actively, like for real, I just kind of thought that I was going to have to live with fear my whole life. But, you know, it's just like, you know, if someone takes medicine only really, most of the time, suppresses the symptoms. It doesn't really take care of the root. And so I felt like maybe, okay, I can maybe suppress the symptoms of fear or whatever. But I always thought I would have to live with that root fear in my life. But the Bible says the Lord is our healer. And whether that's physically or whether that's with fear, you know, depression, anxiety, or whatever it is that you're going through, he can heal you from that or set you free from that, just like from the core. And so we don't have to like deal with that our whole lives. We can take authority and we can shut the enemy out. So we can slam that door shut so he doesn't have a foothold in our lives. And you know, for me, I just, one of the main things to do that is just spending time in God's word. Yeah. You know, like, how are we supposed to know the truth of our lives or the truth of our situation if we don't read the truth, if we don't know the truth? It's like when we read the Bible, we get the full truth, and the lies that the enemy is trying to feed into our minds, feed into our souls, are just like wiped away because we know the truth. It's like, for example, I used to babysit this family. And they're an awesome family. I really love them. But they had two little boys. And these little boys, sometimes they would come up to me and be like, Melissa, mommy and daddy said that we could do this. So, you know, and they would ask my permission. But the thing is that right before the mom and dad left, they told me exactly, like, they're not allowed to do that exact thing they were just asking me to do, you know? And so for me, I was able to recognize, okay, these boys are not telling me the truth here. Because I heard it from a higher authority. I knew the higher authority said that they can't, you know, do that. Mm. So I was able to recognize the lies. And it's the same thing with our walk with God. You know, when we know the truth from the higher authority, when we see that full truth, then we can recognize, okay, the lies that the enemy is trying to put into our minds. And we can put those lies in their rightful place. Just like my mom was saying, just having that and putting it in the rightful place. And sometimes, I know for me growing up, I was like, well, how do I put those thoughts in the rightful place? And so if you look in the Word of God, you see like when Jesus was in the desert for 40 days and he was fasting and praying, the enemy, he came and tried to tempt him and deceive him and, you know, was just pestering him. But what Jesus did was he spoke the word of God. And as soon as he spoke the word of God, the enemy fled. And you know, there's a verse in the Bible, in James 4:7, it says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. And so we see that we resist the devil with the word of God. When we speak out the word of God, the enemy, he has to flee. And you know, just like my mom was saying, just being careful the things that you say, the things that you claim, there's been countless times where I'm with students or, you know, like some students that I'm leading, and they'll tell me, you know, I don't think that I'm good enough, or they'll just like constantly speak down on their lives, you know, and it hurts me because I'm like, oh, you know, there's so much, God just loves them so much, but what we speak is what we start to believe. And so that's something that I'll tell them, what you continuously start to speak is what you will believe. So if you continuously say you're not good enough, you're not talented enough, that's what you're going to believe. But if you start claiming the word of God, no matter how you're feeling, because feelings are very deceiving, if you start claiming the word of God and you say, you know, I am who God says I am, I am what the word of God says, that's when we start to see that victory. And it's actually proven scientifically. I was in a psychology class at college, and the professor, who is not a Christian in any way, was telling us that that it's actually scientifically proven that what you start speaking is what you start believing. She was saying that if you're really sad or you're just not feeling good, and you put a fake smile on your face and you start like saying happy things or you start claiming happy things, that you will become happy. And that's a thing that's proven in the non-Christian world, you know? And so how much more for us who, you know, who have the Lord fighting for us and where the Lord is on our side, when we can claim the word of God, we can claim our victory. Just like claiming those verses that I had in, Joshua 1:9 and 2 Timothy 1:7, claiming those verses over our lives, we can start to see how the enemy flees, how he can't resist the word of God, because the word of God has the highest power. It's the full authority. When we start to do that and we start to spend time with God and we just spend time in his presence and we start to speak out the word of God, we start to understand who God really is. We start to see his characteristics. We start to see who he is. And so many times, you know, when we're... We just have to become confident in who God is. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like, we have to become confident that what he's saying is true, what he has promised us is true. We have to become confident in that. But if we don't spend time with God daily, if we don't have that personal time with God, how are you supposed to become confident of someone that you don't know? You know? Like, for example, let's say a stranger comes up to me and they're like, oh, I have a great surprise for you. Get in the car. We're going to go somewhere. You don't do that. You run because it's a stranger. You have no confidence in that stranger. But if my parents would say, go get in the car, we're going to go somewhere fun, I know that we're like going out to eat or going to do something fun as a family or whatever it is, because I can have confidence that my parents, what they say is true because I've spent time with them. And so it's the same thing. You know, we can have confidence in God, but we need to spend that time with him.
That's right. That's right.
And so just shutting that door to the enemy, it's such an important part. We need to have that door 100% shut, because like my mom was saying, if it's open just a little, if it's open just a crack, the enemy is not a gentleman. He will just, you know, pound in that door and he will invite himself into your life. So we need to completely shut that door, bolt that door shut, just by spending time with God, spending time with the word, becoming confident in who God is and claiming that authority and that victory that we have. You know, we don't try to get as close to the edge of sin without falling in as we can. If sin is like a cavern and there's a cliff and you're safe on the cliff, but if you fall, it's sin. You don't try to get to the edge to see how close before you fall, because your chances of falling are so much higher. You try to get as far away from the edge of that cliff as you possibly can so that you don't fall in. And it's the same thing with just shutting the enemy out. We go above and beyond. We, you know, guard our hearts as well as we can so that the enemy has no foothold whatsoever. So that's all I had to share with you guys. But let's just close in prayer. I'm just going to pray for you guys. Mm-hmm. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for who you are, God. Thank you so much that we can just come before you and learn so much about you, Lord. I just pray that you would give us strength to shut the enemy out, Lord. Shut every door to the enemy, Lord, and that you would just that I just pray for everyone watching, Lord. I pray that they would just have such a desire to pursue you every single day, that they would read their word, that they would claim the word, Lord, that they would guard their mind and their heart, Lord, that they would guard the people, just their relationships, the people that they're hanging out with, and just the words that they speak, Lord. I thank you so much, God, for who you are, and that you just give us full victory and that we can walk in that. But let us also do our part and just close those doors to the enemy so that we can walk in your victory and we can walk in your promises. And we just give you all the glory and praise. We thank you so much in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for watching. Have an incredible day. Be blessed. You know, live a victorious life. It is possible through Christ. We love you guys. Mm-hmm. You know, thank you all who have contacted us. Feel free to continue to do so. We love to hear from you. And remember, Christ is the answer.